Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Glad to see everybody this morning and just glad to be with you as we get together to worship the Lord this morning. So thank you for being here. If you're a guest, as always, we thank you for joining us and thank you for being here this morning. We do hope you feel at home, and we want to connect with you and just see how we can serve you and pray for you. We have our connect cards. They're out in our foyer and they're over in our welcome center, and you can just fill those out after the service this morning and take them over to the welcome center. There'll be somebody there waiting for you, and they'll have a gift for you there. So just thank you for joining us this morning. And if you're at home watching this morning, thank you for being with us. Anytime and any way we can get together and worship the Lord, we're happy to do so. And he's trying to hide in the back, but I'm just thankful to see Rodney back this morning. So this, buddy, I know he's doing well, so we're thankful to have Rodney back this morning. And normally we share a verse at this time, but y'all know me. I like y'all to just share with each other. So turn around and say hello to your neighbor this morning. Give him a hug. Just feels good to say good morning, doesn't it? Now that was weak. Feels good to say good morning, doesn't it? Got to be excited about being together and serving the Lord. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you again for today, and thank you for the love you show us. Thank you for the ability for us to come together and worship in your house. God, just give us the clear mind and clear heart this morning to take in your word, to understand it, to use it, Lord, in our lives, and to use it to touch others as we go through this week. And we pray all this in your precious Son's name. Amen.
Please stand with me as we sing "When We All Get to Heaven." We'll wipe for some more. So there we go. Seated.
As we go into our prayer time this morning, I do have many or several things to share with you. First, just be praying for Pastor Dave and Laura as they are. He's at a conference this weekend. The kids are here, and we're thankful for that because I think, was Seth in control of the house, Grace? No. They all made it, so we're thankful. I'm sure Grace was in control. But just pray for them. They'll be traveling back this weekend, so thankful for that. And I do want to share with you a couple of notes. First, from Dawn and I, thank you very much for just the love you show us and the very generous love offering. We just love you guys. We're so thankful just to be here. And Pastor Dave left you a note, too, and he says thank you so much for the generous love offering and the notebook and all your encouraging notes that you gave me for Pastor Appreciation Month. You are also kind and thoughtful. I will forever cherish the notes you wrote. Thank you for loving me and my family, and it is my great joy to serve you as your pastor. Love, Pastor Dave. And that notebook that we got, I tell you, it's special just to read your words. So just thank you guys so much for doing that. And just to start with our prayer request, pray for all the children who will receive a shoebox, as we've been talking about, for Operation Christmas Shoebox and Operation Christmas Child. Pray that their hearts and the hearts of their families will be open to the gospel, and that many will be saved. And we're right in the middle of that time, so just be praying, because those kids, when they open those boxes, it's a different world for them, and it's an opportunity for us to reach them with the gospel. So pray for that. And I just want to share a praise with you guys. Thank you for everyone that donated, that helped with the yard sale. It is always a pretty massive undertaking to do, but we got out there yesterday, and to date, we've got a little bit more probably coming in, but we've raised over $1,400 to go towards missions. So thank you guys for that. And it was a good day, so we only brought back half of the three trailers we took, so we're all good about that. And we'll be donating that to Durham Rescue Mission, so thank you guys for that. And just continue to pray for our fall festival coming up on Saturday, November the 12th. It's a great opportunity, as we've been telling you, to reach the community. And just pray that we'll invite people to come, that we'll get the community here, and that many people who need a church home will come. And also, obviously, the folks that don't know Jesus, let's pray that they can come and they can hear the gospel shared. And we'll be taking advantage of that opportunity to invite them to church on that day and to know Jesus. And again, that's coming up very quickly. I'll talk to you more about that at the end of the service and give you some information on that. But just be praying for that fall festival on Saturday, November the 12th. And we also need to pray for God's will to be done in the election, as we've been talking about, and that we just vote biblically. You need to go to God's word and just focus on that. And pray for Karma and Grace Carangelin and their family, because their brother Pete passed away unexpectedly on Sunday last week. So be praying for them and their family as they deal with this. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we just thank you again for loving us and for being here to hear our prayers, Lord. And Lord, we know that you're in control, and even when it's times that we don't understand things, we know that you have us. So God, I thank you for hearing our prayer requests. I thank you for the praise reports, Lord, that we're able to share to show how you are working in our lives. Be with the families, Lord, this week that have sick ones. Be with the families that have lost loved ones, Lord. Give them what only you can, Lord, and that's a sense of peace and a sense of love and a sense of strength during this time. Just be with us, Lord, as we go through the service this morning to be guided by you. We pray all these things in your precious Son's name. Amen.
You will hear life
I don't know how Pastor Dave planned it, that two times in a row when I'm preaching, y'all got to see me up here all the time. I'm sorry about that, but thankful to be with you this morning, and thank you, choir. And I tell you what, it's a good thing to sing to the Lord, and that's what they do. It's a good thing to just lift up our voices. And I can tell you on Wednesday nights when we practice, it's just like this, because we just love doing it. So I hope you guys get that out of it, because that's what we want to do, is just worship the Lord. No matter what we're doing, we want to worship the Lord. All right, so we'll get started this morning, and I'll go ahead and give you the title for my message this morning, and it's, Does Your Passion Match His Promise? Does your passion match His promise? And I'm going to ask you a question this morning. We're going to get going right off the bat. I won't ask you to answer out loud, but if you feel the need, you can go ahead and do that. So if I were to ask you this question this morning, what were you most passionate about? What would your answer be? If I were to ask you, what are you most passionate about? What would your answer be? Say that out loud. Getting up in the morning. That's probably a good one for most of us, Don. Getting up in the morning. Well, if you're thinking about that and you've got that thought in your head, here's the next question. If I were to ask five people that know you really well that same question about you, would their answer match yours? Would they say that you're passionate about the same things that you're saying you're passionate about? And here's why I ask you that. Whatever we're passionate about, it should be seen. It should be known to those that are around us. So I'm going to tell you a couple of things that I'm passionate about, worldly things. Now, I know it's an easy thing. I'm going to start off with this, but it's obviously easy for me to say I'm passionate about my beautiful wife, Dawn. Because if I didn't say that, I might get in trouble when I had the rest of this stuff that I'm down. But I'm thankful for Dawn, and somebody asked us yesterday at the yard sale. We met a couple that live here now, but they're from England originally. And they asked us, how long have y'all been together? We said, 32 years we've been married. He said, that's a while. He said, we just celebrated 50. I said, y'all got us by 18 years. And he said, and she's still my cute little girl, just like she was, talking about his wife. And I said, that's what we can all hope for, right? That we have that passion at 50 years of marriage, just like we did when we were dating. So a couple things I'm passionate about other than my beautiful wife, Dawn, is I love Wake Forest University sports. I do. I love them. If anybody doesn't know that about me, my brother played football at Wake Forest from 1976 through 1979, so I've been going to games since 1976. Now, if you know anything about sports, and some of you are looking at me like, I don't, but just stick with me. Wake Forest is not a perennial powerhouse. They're not the Alabamas of the college sports world, but that makes it even a little more special to me. Because it's special to me when they win, and it's special to me to be a small amount of group that they're growing now, but a small amount of group of fans that pulls for Wake Forest. But now, I don't miss too many games. I listen by radio or do stuff like that. But I'm passionate about that. I'm also passionate about outdoors. I like doing anything outdoors. I like being in the woods. I like hunting. We do a lot of camping. I enjoy those kind of things. And they're fun things for me to do. And I tell you about these things that I'm passionate about because I use them in my life. I use them as a passion check on my life. What am I most passionate about? And I use that as a check when it comes to how am I passionate about God. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. Now, it's not wrong to be passionate about the things I've spoken about, or maybe you're passionate about the things that you've thought about this morning when I ask you this question. But my question to myself, my question I'm asking you this morning is, does our passion for God stand high above all the other things that we're passionate about in our life? And remember that question I asked you. When I ask you this, does your passion for God stand high above all the other passions you have in your life? If you said yes, amen. If I were to go ask those five friends I told you about a little while ago, would they say, yep, that's the most passionate thing in their life? Because we should love God and be so passionate about Him and what He's done for us that people can see it without us ever having to say it by the way we live. So that's what we're going to talk about this morning. I just want to give you a little thought process as you go into it of what you could be thinking about it. So does God's love for you and the promise of eternity for those that are saved stir a passion in you to act? Think about that statement this morning. Think about that question. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 6 through 10. You can make your way there. I'll read it and I'll reread it as we go through it this morning. But Paul is speaking to the group of believers here, and he's explaining to them a promise that God gave us. And I want you to think about this promise as we go through this morning. And does your passion match this promise that God has given us? So he's telling us, Paul's telling us here about the power of the Holy Spirit, and we receive a promise from God through that Holy Spirit, and it's the most powerful thing we can ever have. All the leaders of earth back then, now, the most powerful, the most rich, the most wise, they cannot receive this without faith. There's nothing you can do in this world to gain this except ask Jesus. And that's what Paul was going to be talking about this morning. So I'm going to share this scripture, and then we'll break them down a verse at a time, and we'll see what we're getting into. We'll start in verse 6. It says, however, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory, which none of the rulers of this age knew, for had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eyes have not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man, but God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. All right, so I know that's a lot of scripture right there together to tie in. It's a lot of good stuff there. So we're going to break them down a verse at a time. And we're going to give ourselves a passion check during these verses, all right? Give yourself some opportunity to have a little homework and a little way as you go through the week. You can check yourself and see where your passion lies, because I think that's important for us to do. It's important for us to know where our most passionate feelings are at. So first in verse 6, Paul has explained that the wisdom God is giving believers comes through the Holy Spirit. I'm going to read that verse 6 for you again. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age, who are coming to nothing. The rulers of that time, with all their earthly wisdom, could not understand the wisdom of God. They couldn't do it. Paul said it was a mystery to them because they did not believe Jesus was the Son of God. And because of that, they did not have the Holy Spirit within them to impart this godly wisdom that all believers are capable of having. So let's think about this. You can have all the wealth in the world. You can have all the worldly knowledge. You can be as wise as anyone. But if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, what Paul is saying is, you don't know anything. Because that's where it starts and that's where it ends when it comes to the truth. Now, you might say, well, there's a lot of people in this world that have it great. Well, if you look at it from a worldly standard, you could think that. But God promises us that this is not the end. And we were promised eternity. And eternity is way much, so much better than whatever you can think of here on this earth. That should make us passionate. That should make us passionate. Paul is obviously passionate about what he's speaking of here. And he says, the rulers of this age, they're coming to nothing. They're coming to nothing. All they know, all the power they have, all the wealth they have, it's going to go away. How do we know that to be true? Well, let's just look at our history. No matter how old you are, rulers don't rule forever. Money doesn't last forever. And worldly wisdom can get you into trouble. Would everybody agree with those statements? Rulers don't rule forever, money doesn't last forever, and worldly wisdom can get you into trouble. But God's word leads you to where you need to be every time. And to accept that, to get that, you have to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. You have to believe that. And that's what Paul was saying here. They can't do it. The rulers of that time could not understand that. We're all capable of having that wisdom as believers. We're capable of it, but we still have to do something. It requires a passion from us. It requires an understanding that we have to be passionate on the part of every believer to desire God's word. We have to want it, and we have to want to share it. Now, I'm just going to speak as plainly as I can right now. I think believers today are all about the getting from God, but we're not too good on the giving from God. We don't want to share like we take in. We should be passionate. You should be so passionate that wherever God takes you when you leave here today, between here and your house, if the opportunity arises, you should want to share something about the Lord. That's a passion that God wants us to have, and he's given us that through his wisdom, but we have to seek it. We have to want it. And that's what Paul is talking about here. It's capable, every believer is capable of having that passion, but we have to want to cherish it. We have to want to use it, and we have to want to learn it daily, to grow in it daily. And then we'll go to verse 7, and Paul says this. Paul shows us that the wisdom was created by God, and listen to this, the last part of this, for us, for our glory. I'm going to read it. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory. Now that's an amen moment to me. I don't know about y'all. You can say it. It's okay. No. If you're going to say amen to the Lord, you say it like you mean it. are you happy for what God's done for you before you ever were thought of?
Amen.
Now take that right there and go out every day and carry that thought process. Thank you, Lord, for thinking about me and thinking about my glory before I was ever thought of, and what you've done for me. Look at that verse again. We speak the wisdom, we believers, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory. I don't deserve any glory, but God through his grace allows us to live in his glory. And he set all this up for all who will just believe. And what Paul was saying there is, these guys, they don't get it. These leaders of today, they don't understand it. But you do. You have the chance to reach someone. Is it any different today, sitting right here in this room, than it was when Paul spoke these words? We all have it. If we believe, if you believe, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have this wisdom given to you through the Holy Spirit, ready to be used at any time that you're willing to put the effort in to reach those around you. That's a gift that we cannot overlook. We cannot put that by the wayside. So if you're thinking about verses 6 and 7, and then we look at what Paul says there at the end, it's not the wisdom of the world, it's the wisdom of God. Paul is telling us that the wisdom of knowing God and knowing Jesus as our Savior gives us what no lost soul can have. No matter how rich or how intelligent or how powerful, we have godly wisdom because we believe. In this world today, I'm just saying personally, maybe you'll agree with this, the world needs godly wisdom. Everybody agree with that? Yeah, I'm going to make y'all talk this morning, so just go ahead and get ready. If you agree with it, what are you doing about it? Don says, not enough. Me either, Don. How passionate are we about it when we leave this room? Monday through Friday, how passionate are you about it when you get an opportunity? We had a great opportunity yesterday. I can't tell you how many people came to the yard sale. Hundreds. Had a great opportunity to share, to talk with people, to tell them what the yard sale was. Every dime, penny we raised, you guys know, goes all towards our missions that we do. And got to tell them about our missions that our church is involved with locally, out of state, across the world. And people were just amazed. They were just amazed. And you get to see that they start wondering, wow, there's something to this. This isn't just a yard sale. And you know what happens? I don't know why, but God moves them, right? Because, listen, we don't set any prices at this yard sale. It's all donations. We tell them it's all for missions and all donations. We set no prices. And I would say 90% of the people give us more money. They say, nope, just keep it. Just keep it. Just keep it. Now, all those people aren't saved, but God's moving. Some of them have been to that yard sale several times. Might be the only time they hear about God all year. I don't know. But I know that God moves there. When we're willing in anything we do, whether it be a yard sale, whether it be pumping gas, whether it be talking to your family, whether it be at your work, God is moving every time we're willing. And as a believer, you've got the ability to do it. We've got to be passionate like that. We have to be. So here's your first passion check this morning. Are you ready? First passion check. Are you as fired up as you can be about the wisdom of God in your life? When you think about what God has given you, his wisdom to do his will in your life, are you fired up about that? Or do you let the world and what you have to do with your everyday routine sort of squash that excitement? We have to be a people who wake up and go to bed excited about what God's doing. And I'm just going to be honest with you, I don't think we're there. I know in my life, I don't wake up and go to bed every day excited about what God's doing. But when I take the time to stop and thank him for what he's doing, man, does my day change. Does my life change. Our youth, we've been going through in the last few weeks, we've gone through a deal talking about What do you want people to see Jesus like in you? How do you want people to see Jesus in your life? And one of the things that we do is we call them, we got to recognize the what? The Jesus, what girls? Jesus moments? Yeah. Was it hard when we first started thinking about Jesus moments? But then when we spent about 15 minutes, everybody started coming up with the Jesus moments that they had had that day. And it started with one, and then it went to five, and then it went to 10, and then it went to 15. You want to get passionate about God? Stop and think about all the things He does in your day for you. The problem He keeps you from, the trouble He keeps you from getting into, the great things He does for you. We have to be a people that are mindful of who God is and the wisdom He gives us. And by doing our Jesus moments, if y'all remember nothing else, remember those two words, Jesus moments. Think about those daily. What is Jesus doing in your life every day? It doesn't have to be a huge thing. It can be small things. They came up with, well, I got an extra day between having to take my test. Right, Emma? Yep, she got an extra day. She didn't have to take her test. So that was an extra day to study. That's a Jesus moment. You can say what you want to about it. But God is in control of our lives. He's either in control of your life or He's not. It's 100 or 0. So you have to recognize Him for who He is and what He does. So, are you fired up about the wisdom of God? Do you take the wisdom given to believers by the Holy Spirit for granted? Do you take that wisdom that God gives you as a believer for granted? It's a gift that we cannot overlook. I'll say it again. You can't overlook it. The wisdom of God gives us the ability to find joy in every day by doing this one thing, sharing that gift that He gave us. The gift of wisdom is the gift of salvation. I don't know if y'all see where I'm going with this. But that's the biggest wisdom that God imparts to us, is how to spend eternity with Him. So are we fired up about it? And then we go to verse 8. Paul goes further here. He's calling out the leaders of the day. Let's look at that. Which none of the rulers of this age knew, for had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Pretty clear, right? What is Paul saying there? He's speaking about the Jewish and the Roman leaders of the time, the ones that took Jesus to the cross, right? And he's saying they obviously didn't know. They obviously did not believe that Jesus was the Son of God. Therefore, they have no understanding of the Holy Spirit's wisdom. They don't have it in their lives. It's given to believers. From the second you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, the Holy Spirit enters you and He's with you for eternity. And He's our guide. He's our person that God gives us that lives with us, because we know it's one in three. And He guides us every day. I can't imagine going through this life without the Holy Spirit. I can't imagine making decisions that I've had to make in my life as I look back without going to God first. And often. And when I haven't gone to God first and often, those were some bad decisions. I'll just go and tell you. But when I do, it makes a big difference. So Paul was saying here, they don't understand it. They didn't even have an idea of what this wisdom was. He said, the wisdom of salvation through Christ and the promise of eternity was mind-blowing. This is from a little commentary. It was mind-blowing to these so-called wise leaders. Mind-blowing. Everybody knows what that means, right? You just can't comprehend what is being said. Why, as believers, can we comprehend what God lays on our heart and the lost cannot? Holy Spirit. I heard it. It's one thing. It's the Holy Spirit. And that's what Paul is talking about here. And I'm hitting this morning because I want you to fully understand when you go out this week, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, and if you don't, I'll be talking to you here in just a few minutes, because you might be thinking, what is this we're talking about this morning? I'll let you know about it here in just a few minutes. But if you're a believer, this week should be different for you. Tomorrow should be different from you. You shouldn't get back here next Sunday and go, nothing really different happened this week. We should never have a week like that as believers, because we should be putting ourselves out there every day to do the things that we can only do because we have the wisdom of God. You want the leadership of our country and our world to change? Get out there and tell the truth. Start reaching people. I think about Jesus and I think about Paul. They didn't have, as Pastor Dave says all the time, they didn't have all the fancy technology we have today. I just love that technology, don't I, Emma? Yeah, I'm not a technology guy, if you don't know that. My kid, the youth always pick on me. But they didn't have anything but feet and word of mouth, right? And yet, over 2,000 years later, what they started cannot be stopped. Because they were passionate, and it's true. You can't knock truth down. You can do whatever you want to do to try to skew it, but you can't knock truth down. Because truth is God, and God is truth. And if we're passionate and we go to reach the people around us, things will change. Have they changed in your life when you sought after God? Oh, okay, y'all obviously asleep, because if not, that should have been an amen. Have things changed in your life when you sought after God? If they didn't, we're going to go back and start all over again. If they have changed in your life, why in the world would we not want to help other people have that same change? And that's what we're here for. That's what God puts us here for. So these leaders didn't understand it. Paul is talking about that. He said, I just were thinking about this. Their hearts were hardened to the truth, even though Paul, who was originally one of them, was testifying to what had changed in his life. Who was Paul? Saul. Who was Saul? Christian, yeah, he's a persecutor. Loved putting Christians in jail, having them tortured, having them killed in some instances. Loved it. Passionate about that. That's Paul's words, not mine. Before that trip on Damascus and on that road where he had a divine encounter, he was a totally different guy. And the book doesn't lie about it, right? But when he became Paul and he knew the truth, so he thought he knew the truth before, but then the truth was in front of him and he couldn't deny it. He changed. Do we see anywhere, and we know Paul wrote most of the New Testament, virtually a fair amount of the New Testament. Do we see anywhere where Paul's passion drops off? No. This guy was walking hundreds of miles, not taking money, not taking food from anybody, working his way so that he could preach the gospel over years. Let's just not even mention he was imprisoned, beaten, stoned, and we never see his passion waver. Because he knew the truth. He knew what the end was. We should live every day knowing what the end is. You know, like when you're a kid and it's Christmas, you know, oh man, it's 6 days to Christmas. Oh, it's five. I've been good this year. It's 5 days to Christmas. 4 days to Christmas. I'm going to get something. I just know Santa Claus is going to bring me something good. How much more as adults should we be thinking like that for our time with the Lord if we believe and have accepted Jesus Christ our Savior? I'm getting closer. Let me tell everybody about it. There is something good waiting for me, and it can be waiting for you too. Let me tell you about it. Romans 3:23 is my favorite verse in the Bible. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's because we're all alike except for the grace of God. And he'll give equally to all those who want to come to him. We should be passionate about that. Passionate about it. So God gives his children everything through wisdom. The world cannot. And the world does not understand it. But through Jesus, God desires for everyone to have this wisdom. We have to be passionate about sharing what God desires for everybody to have. And that's the wisdom of God, our Creator, who desperately wants us to share this wisdom every day. Every day, in some way. We're talking to youth a lot about all the different ways that we can share the gospel. It's not always about going in and just speaking to somebody and reading straight biblical. Those are great times, and I encourage you to do that. But it's also about what we can do for somebody. It's also about how we can help people. I don't know how many times the Baptist men have gone over the years and done stuff for people, and they go, the question I keep hearing them when they come back and they talk about it, the people say, why are you doing this? Whoosh, doors open. By the grace of God. God calls us to do it. He loves you just like he loves us. That's what God does when we're willing. We got to be focused and ready to understand those type of things. Passion check time number two. You guys ready? Do you seek to share the wisdom, or do you shy away from it? Do you seek to share the wisdom, or do you shy away from it? As a believer, do you truly want others to know what you know? Now, I know it's easy for us to say that. Oh, yeah, definitely I do. But you think about your life and how you handle the blessings that God has given you and continues to give. Do you truly in your heart every day go, man, I really want other people to have this. What can I do, God, to share it? That's passion that we need to have. It doesn't matter what you're doing in your life, where your work is at, where you're at in school, whether you're retired, your passion every day is developed from your relationship with God. Go to him and ask him to get you passionate about serving and see what happens. Now be ready, because when you ask God, he's going to give you an opportunity. And then you got to decide whether you're going to take it or not. But when we take it, the passion stirs inside of us for what God does. Do you truly want people to have what you have? And are you passionate about sharing it? And here's the last question of this passion check. Are you living your life in such a way that makes the people around you want that same wisdom that you have? Simply put, believers, do the lost see a difference in you? Can a lost person look at you as a believer without you having to say a word and go, something different about that person? I want to know what that is. I see it on their face. I don't understand it, but I want to ask them about it. See, as believers, our passion should be so bright that people can see it by how we live our life every day, even in the tough days. I know we all have tough days. We all have hard times. Some of us have hard years. I thought back through my life just the last few years and ups and downs and things that have gone on in my life. And did I share the passion of God during those times? Probably not as good sometimes as others, but I tried. Through my mom and dad, both of them passed away from cancer early on in their life. And then I guess about three years ago now, me going for a regular checkup and finding out I had cancer. And then, you know, having to go through what so many of you have gone through and are still going through. And I just remember, because Dawn, my wife's been a nurse for about 35, 36 years, she always knows somebody, wherever we go doing something medical, she knows them. So, of course, these nurses in this area, they knew Dawn, and they're all in there talking. And the doctor came in, and with such love and kindness, she said, we found a tumor, I think it's cancer. I'm going to send you to a doctor, and she walked out. That's how I got the news. And I looked around, and all the nurses were sad. And the first thing I can think about saying is, I'm not worried about it. God's in control. Now, you got to give it over to him during those times, right? So those were three words I said because they comforted me, because I know God's in control. But you know what else I saw? They comforted those that were around me. Because some of them I could tell were believers, and it hit them just like that. We got to be passionate all the time about what God does in our life. Whether he healed me here or he healed me forever, he's going to heal me. I know it's coming one way or the other. I'm going to be healed. We got to be passionate. Verses 9 and 10, I'm going to group it with you, okay? It reveals to us the ultimate prize of the wisdom of God, the gospel. Let's look at 9 and 10. But as it is written, eyes have not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. Paul is telling us here that human wisdom, as we've been talking about, cannot comprehend this wonderful gift of salvation through Jesus. We can't understand why a person would come live a perfect life and be tortured, ridiculed, and die on a cross for you and me, except for after we ask Jesus Christ into our heart. And then we know the love of God. And once you know the love of God, you understand why somebody would do that. I thought about, I know we have a lot of veterans in here. I'm a veteran, served in the Army. I know we've got, I think, all four branches pretty much every time. And I always think about serving in the Army is like being a Christian. It's about service and sacrifice. It's about giving something up so that others can live freely and be safe, at least in my opinion. And I think about that when it compares to being a Christian. Our life should be about service. because of the sacrifice that was given for us. And if we are asked to sacrifice something in this world, it's nothing compared to what was given for us. We should be passionate not only about serving, but because of why we should serve, because of the sacrifice on the cross. Now, this is the time where we're getting close to the end, and I bet some of you had to stay up late last night. And everybody's tired, a couple nodding. But I just want you to think ahead to your week, what you already know or what you think you know is going to happen, because we can't plan the next minute. What's coming up this week that you're passionate about? I'll tell you a story. Last time I was preaching, I was pretty excited because I was going to get to go with my uncle and a buddy of ours, and we were going to get to go hunting in Ohio. That's a good, just a trip I look forward to. I love being outside. So I was preaching. I was leaving, going to leave church straight from here, ran to my office, changed, and I'm headed. It's about an 8.5-hour drive to where we hunt. And I jumped in, and I'm about told Dawn goodbye, and about halfway down Highway 57, and I get a call. And it's Dawn. And I can tell she's upset. And she told me that her uncle just died, unexpectedly. And it just hit me like a rock. And of course, Dawn, being my beautiful, loving wife, that you know the first thing she said? You go ahead, I'll be fine. Ugh. I'm like, don't say that to me. So I pulled into the gas station, and I hung up with her. I called my uncle and him. I said, hey, I'm going home. Told him what happened. The end result of that was, through God's grace, I was asked to speak at the funeral, of which they had over 400 at the graveside. And then he had a life celebration. He was a golf coach at NC State for 46 years. Had a life celebration at State. Had over 2,000 in attendance there. The gospel was shared at both places. Passionate. As we get opportunities, we need to be passionate. And just to show you that God has a great sense of humor, as I got up to share at the graveside, I had my phone so stuff wouldn't blow away because it's outside, and all my scriptures on my phone, and I get up and my phone dies. As if to say, you better know what you're talking about. But as God does, he laid it on my heart. He reminded me of what I wanted to say and the scripture I wanted to share. And it was awesome to see people come up and talk about the gospel being shared. We've got to be passionate because of what God's done for us. Human wisdom can't comprehend it, but the godly wisdom we receive once we ask Jesus Christ into our heart can. If you're here this morning and you have not asked Jesus Christ into your heart, we're going to have a time of invitation here in just a few minutes. You come down front, I'll talk to you about it. There's nothing that you will ever experience that can touch asking Jesus into your heart. And he desperately wants to be there. Paul in verse 10 concludes by us talking about this. He says, the Holy Spirit is the only way that we'll receive this wisdom because it comes from God and God alone. He reveals himself to us through the Holy Spirit, and only through the Holy Spirit will we receive this wisdom. There's not another way. Just like there is no other way to heaven except through Jesus Christ, our Savior, there's no other way to the wisdom of God except through Jesus and accepting him and having the Holy Spirit come live in your heart. And through that, you become passionate. Or we should be, believers. We should be. We all get knocked down. Let me tell you a secret. If you're not getting knocked down as a Christian, you're not in the right ballgame. Now, I told y'all I was a big Wake Forest fan. Let me tell you how the Lord shared just how this message was going to play out for me. We got home from the yard sale yesterday, and I was pretty excited. We got it done in time, and I got to sit down and watch Wake Forest. They were ranked 10th in the country right now in football. 10th in the country. That's like twice in my lifetime. And they go play an unranked team in Louisville, and they get whipped. I mean whipped. It's not close from beginning to end. Never seen it happen. I think they had 5 turnovers this whole year. They had 6 in one quarter. So I told Dawn, when you hear my message tomorrow, you're going to be really laughing about this. Now, God didn't change that game to teach me a lesson, but he used it to see where my passion was. Was I going to be as passionate this morning to get up here and talk to y'all after a Wake Forest loss as I would have been if they'd have won by 40? Yes, I am, because God is good. And he blesses us. Last passion check for you. Do you seek the Holy Spirit's direction in your life? Are you excited when God puts opportunities in your life to share the gospel? Think about those two things. Do you seek the Holy Spirit's direction in your life? And are you excited when God puts opportunities in your life to share the gospel? Think about Paul again, a man that was a hater of Jesus, a hater of Christians. But once he believed, there was nobody more passionate. Believer, are you passionate about the truth that you know? Passionate enough not to hold it inside. Passionate enough to make it first in your day, in your busy day, because I know you're busy. We're all busy. Are we busy doing the Lord's work? Because we do that wherever we're at. If you're here this morning, you fall into one of two categories. You've either asked Jesus into your heart and accepted him as your Savior, or you have not. That's how God looks at us. We're lost or we're saved. There is no in between. The wisdom given to believers is available to all who seek Jesus to be their Savior. And God's desire for us is to know him and know his wisdom. Like I said, if you've not made that decision this morning, I know God is moving in your heart right now. And you come down during this time of invitation and talk with me. Don't leave here without making the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. Don't do it. It'll change your life. Believer, I'm asking you this morning, where's your passion? Is your passion lined up with the promise that God has given you? Is the most exciting thing you think about every week your opportunity to share the gospel? If it's not, then the wisdom of God is waiting in your heart this morning for you to just open it up and say, God, send me, I'm ready. Whoever you've got in front of me today, tomorrow, and the rest of the week, I'm going to open my mouth and you're going to speak, God, because you say you're going to do it. But I'm going to be willing to do it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you for this morning. And just thank you for the love you show for us, Lord. And thank you for giving us the gift of your wisdom. To all that ask you, Lord, to all that ask your Son to be their Savior, Lord. Thank you for blessing us with that wisdom. And Lord, the ones that are here this morning, I don't know, but you do. If they have not asked Jesus Christ into their heart, Lord, I pray they'll do that this morning. Whether it's in the pew, whether it's coming down front to me, Lord, I pray that you're working in their hearts right now. For the believers, Lord, that we're here this morning, Lord, stir our passion. Make us focus on the people you want us to focus on this week and the message you want us to send, Lord. Not what we have to say, but what you have to say. We pray all these things in your precious Son's name. Amen. Please stand as we sing. Yeah. All right. Again, just a reminder, if you're a guest, thank you for being here. And please go over to the Welcome Center. They do have a gift for you this morning. They want to meet you there. Ladies, join us for our Women's Bible Study this Tuesday at 6:45 p.m. And they will be meeting in the Family Life Center this Tuesday at 6:45. And we're also continuing to collect for Operation Christmas Child Shoebox. The shoeboxes are still in the Welcome Center, along with brochures that tell you how to pack the shoebox and an information sheet you can put in the shoebox so that your child who receives it can get to know you. You can pick up as many shoeboxes as you want. If you don't use them all, just bring them back so someone else can use them. And again, as we said earlier, our fall festival will be on Saturday, November the 12th, and we do need your help inviting people to come and serving in different areas. You can pick up some flyers that are over in the Welcome Center as well, and there's a sign-up sheet there if you want to help out in certain areas. I know folks were signing up this morning before we had service, so go over there and read and see where you can help as we look to serve and reach out to our community. And as we said last week, Christmas is just around the corner, and that means it's time for Christmas play practice. So our first practice is going to be Sunday, November the 6th from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m., and it's going to be here in the sanctuary. There is a sign-up sheet over in the Welcome Center for that, and all children through teenagers or who are interested, please sign up and go ahead and do that today so they'll start having a count of knowing how many folks will be here. And ladies, it's time to sign up for the 2023 Women of Joy Conference, and they're going to be attending that May 5th through the May 7th, and the conference will be in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. A sign-up sheet and more information about that conference is also available in the Welcome Center, and a $25 deposit is due by December 2nd. You can make all those checks out to Red Mountain Baptist Church, and you can reach out to Jen Scholl if you have any questions about that. And our STU is next Saturday. It'll be ready. If you've signed up for STU, it'll be ready for pickup around 11:15. If you sign up for ingredients, we'll need those here. I'll be here from 5 to 6 on Friday night to take ingredients in, or by 7 a.m. Saturday morning. We have sold out of the STU. I've got some folks on a waiting list in case we make more than we think, but we're just thankful to the Lord we sold out of the STU, so good for that. If you drop off your ingredients anytime before Friday or even on Friday, please have your name on it so we'll know who brought what. Thanks for that. And just a reminder, our fun bunch, we call them the fun bunch, we went on a trip to the mountains this past Tuesday, and it was fun. Right, Ellen? Right, it was fun. Yeah. A lot of shopping on that trip. I don't know how that works out all the time, but a lot of shopping on that trip. But we're going to be taking our next trip Tuesday, November the 15th, to the Fruitcake Factory. If you've never been, it's a great trip. You need to go. It's got a big tour. Family operation started with a grandma making fruitcakes so long ago. Now they've got about a 35,000 square foot warehouse on their farm, and she lives across the street still. So it's neat to go see that. We'll be meeting at church at 7 a.m. on Tuesday, the November the 15th, and there is a sign-up sheet over in the Welcome Center for that as well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you again for today. Thank you for sharing your words with us, Lord. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for speaking to our hearts. Announce up to us, God. Give us opportunities this week to go out and serve you and show folks how much love you have for them by the way we treat them. And we pray all of these things in your precious Son's name. Amen.